Hi, this is B.K. Sharma from University of Illinois, and I'll be speaking on thermochemical conversion of renewable or waste biomass materials to biooils. There are two major routes for converting biomass to biofuels, a biochemical and another one is thermochemical. In biochemical, biomass is first depolymerized to sugars using enzymatic or chemical method and then fermented to ethanol. The other process is thermochemical, and as the name suggests, it uses heat to convert biomass to intermediates, which are then upgraded to fuels using heat and pressure in the presence of catalysts. In thermochemical, there are different technologies depending on the temperature used. One is gasification, that uses high temperature to mix in gas, which can be converted into Fischer Tropp liquid fuels, while pyrolysis produces bioils. At ASTC, our focus is on these two technologies, pyrolysis and hydrothermal liquefaction. Pyrolysis occurs in the absence of oxygen to form bioils, which can be refined to hydrocarbon products, and it's good for dry feedstocks. On the other hand, HTL is ideal for high moisture feedstocks, such as algae, duckweed, sludge, which can be processed in liquid phase media at low temperatures and pressures of 5 to 15 megapascals. And in these processes, what actually happens is different biopolymers present in biomass gets depolymerized, such as lignins form phenols, lipids form hydrocarbons, and fatty acids form hydrocarbons. Depending on the feedstock source and land use, there are four different categories, starting from use of food crops such as corn or soybean to produce corn ethanol as first generation to use of CO2 in the fourth generation. To avoid food versus fuel debate, we are keeping our focus on non-food crops such as miscanthus and switchgrass that can be grown on marginal land, and crop residue such as corn stover for making third generation biofuels. Now we'll go over various examples of producing renewable fuels from various feedstocks. Here we compare two routes to form bioils. First is extraction to remove lipids and then making bioils. And depending on the feedstock composition and process, bioil yields obtained were also different. For example, high lipids, endosmus, and HTL process yielded more bioils compared to low lipid feedstock. Another feedstock that we are using is coffee ground, which has 15% triglyceride and FFA and can be converted into biodiesel, while the defatted coffee ground can be converted into bioil and biochar. At ISTC, we have also shown that by using waste lipids such as soapstock or waste fryer oil, we can produce green gasoline as well as diesel compared to biodiesel process, which only produces diesel in that process. Some other feedstocks that we are also experimenting with are waste plastic and used tires. Waste plastics form 12% of municipal solid waste, while used tires form 2%. 300 million scrap tires are disposed each year. Using pyrolysis process, we depolymerize this waste plastic and scrap tires into hydrocarbons, which can be upgraded and distilled into gasoline and diesel. And this helps to extend the life of extending landfills, and it also improves the carbon utilization efficiency. All these bio-oils are then characterized using appropriate methods to upgrade into biofuels. For example, elemental composition provides calorific values of these bio-oils, and it varies from 33 to 37 megajoules per kilogram. GC FID simdist method used at ISTC provides boiling point distribution, so it provides information on kerosene, gasoline, diesel, lube base oil present in these fuels. GCMS provides compound type distribution in these bioils. Pyro GCMS can be used to simulate pyrolysis on small scale and is currently used for the product optimization. So now we have all these methods to characterize these bioils, and we are working on processes to integrate in biorefineries and ways to improve quality of bioils and biochar and extract to make value-added chemicals or products from these materials. So why are we doing all this? The biggest motivation is renewable fuel standard, which requires the production of transportation fuel in the amount of 36 billion gallons from current numbers of 16 billion gallons. And it lays the foundation for reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, reducing imported petroleum, and it also extends the nation's renewable fuel sector. Thank you.